Good morning, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Dropping the Gloves. Thanks for joining us here. Appreciate the support. Tim, feels like I just talked to you last night. Doesn't it seem like that?
Crazy. I was just thinking, yeah, this is the third day in a row we've recorded the show. And it's not a lot of podcasts that go three times a week for 45 minutes. And now this week is 3 days in a row. It's a lot. It's a lot. I'm getting a little, I've had enough of you.
Fatigued? John Scott fatigue?
John Scott fatigue, yeah.
It happens. You should see my house. It happens daily in my house. But yeah, the reason we're doing this is because, well, I'm going out of town, so I have to kind of condense, consolidate, expedite these podcasts because it's a big time of year. And also, we did the Matt Duchene interview yesterday, and that's very exciting. We teased him a while ago. We got Matt Duchene. He's coming on. It's going to be great. And then you know how hockey players are. Just a rigmarole of actually nailing him down. Tim does most of the scheduling, and it's tough, Tim, because these guys say they want to come on, and then they, you know, go away for 3 days, and they're back, and this and that. So we finally nailed him down. We said, that's enough. Enough is enough. Playoffs are started. We got to get this interview done, and he was nice enough to give us some time last night, and we had a good chat. Good 45-minute talk. It was really, really nice. You don't know what to expect. He's a talker.
He is. A lot of his answers were like, you know, you had to interrupt him to get back into the conversation. But he was ready to talk, and he had some things, particularly the Nashville thing. You know, if you look back, if you listen, we probably spent at least 10 minutes of listening to him talk about how it happened, his reaction, his wife, his friends calling, how he thinks about it. You know, a year later, it's clearly had a huge impact on him, where he said in the show that he was going to spend the rest of his life there. So. Yeah, look forward to listening to that for sure.
Yeah, and I wasn't going to bring it up, but he's the one who instigated that topic a couple times. He's just said, you know, what happened in Nashville? I was so unexpected. And then I felt prompted to just kind of dive into it because here we go. We were just going to stay current Dallas Stars, but no, it was good. Check it out. It's a very good interview. If you haven't heard it already, when are we releasing this episode, Tim? I don't know how we're doing this.
This one will be released today, Wednesday. Duchene will come out Thursday or Friday.
All right. So listen to that one tomorrow. It's going to be a good one. Like I said, we're piling up podcasts here just because there's so much to talk about. And the interview, you can kind of put that anywhere. But yeah, he's excited. They'll actually figure out if they win the Western Conference title tonight. Because Vancouver did win last night, so they're still in the hunt. They're only a couple points behind Dallas. They both have one game left. Dallas plays tonight. So maybe by the time the show airs, they will be the number one team. And he actually gives a good, candid answer on his take on the Vegas Golden Knights and that whole situation and who he wants to play and this and that. So it was I pushed him a little bit. I was pressing him.
You did.
At one point, Tim messaged me because we have our little side message system while we're doing interviews. He's like, be nice to him. You're being really mean.
You were. You're coming on strong in the first 7-8 minutes, but
no, you just don't know how guys talk.
I do know how guys talk.
You're used to talking like metro sexual guys. I'm okay. Like a man's man. That's how they talk. They bust each other's chops, Tim.
Sure. Okay. Whatever you say.
That's right.
Whatever you say, John.
Don't forget it. Before we get too far ahead of ourselves, we need to tell you guys that this show is brought to you by Wendy's. And the only thing sweeter than the taste of victory is starting your day off with the new Cinnabon Pull Apart from Wendy's. Delicious. But there's no reason you can't have both now that Wendy's and Daily Faceoff Fantasy are giving you a chance to win weekly prizes all season long. Season's over, so you better get after it. And hey, even if you make a few wrong picks, at least you know heading to Wendy's right now for a $5 Cinnabon pull apart and small coffee, it's a great choice. Not a medium coffee, small coffee. So sign up for Daily Faceoff today, sponsored by Wendy's and the Wendy's app. You don't want to have too much coffee, especially after having a big old Cinnabon. You know what I mean? A little sip. When I was, funny story, when I went to, where were we at? We're in Portugal, and we get there, we get off the flight, we get to rent a car, me, my wife, and my newborn. We went there last year. We did Portugal, Fatima, and then we went to Rome, Italy, and so we made a big tour of it. Anyways, Portugal, I was tired. I was dragging, you know, a long flight, all day in the airports and this and that with the newborn. So it's a lot. I'm like, I need a coffee. I'm not a huge coffee guy, but I drink it. It just gives me a little pep in my step. I go to the gas station. I'm like, coffee, coffee. And they speak Portuguese. I speak American or English, I should say. The guy comes back with like this little Dixie cup with like a coffee. And I'm like, no. Grande. I'm saying grande to this guy in Lisbon, Spain, Portugal, whatever. Grande, grande. And he's like, I have no clue what you're saying, dummy. I don't speak Spanish here. I don't know what's going on. So I guess they don't do coffees there. They just do like a little espresso. So I finally figured it out once I got to the next place. You have to get an Americano or something. And it's just like an espresso mixed with water. But man, the first stop, I had three of those little shooter cups. I was buzzing. It was absolutely on fire. It was great. But anyways, so if you're, I don't know where, it was Portugal. It was Portugal, not Spain. Yeah, Portugal. Is Lisbon in Portugal? I think it is.
Yeah, it's the capital. I haven't been to either, but I'd like to.
You should go. It was relatively cheap flights, just on a whim. We're checking flights. Let's go. We did this twice. We did it also when we went to Sweden and Norway a few years back. We were just randomly, we shared a bottle of wine and we were looking at flights and we're like, gosh, like kids fly free or some deal like that. And it was like 10 p.m. We're like, okay, booking flights like 7 months in advance. Then we just sat on it. We didn't even think about it. And then like we get a notification saying, oh, are you excited for your trip? Like, oh boy, we just start booking places and stuff. Because that's the way to live your life, Tim. Just, you know, no plans, no thought process goes in.
I'm writing that down. I'm taking notes.
No, you're not. I'm watching you. You liar. You think you got all figured out, mister. I'm dating, you know, hottie patati. I'm 33 now. I got five jobs.
By the way, Duchene was like, man, I hate when people point out the fact that I'm 33. And I was like, I'm 33. I almost said something, but I didn't.
It's different for a hockey player, though, because I'll say that, because you start so much younger and you retire, you're done at 35, 36. So once you get past 30, like the clock is ticking.
Yeah, my career's ahead of me. His is on the back nine. You know, it's weird.
Yeah, I told my wife that a lot when we were dating and then married. I peaked at 30. That was it. That was peak John. I was in incredible physical shape. I was playing at the highest level of hockey I ever played at. And then post 30, it went downhill. So I'm sure Duchene's feeling the same way. It's like, you know, it's not going to get any better. It gets worse. Then you got to live for 50 more years. Ugh, it's awful. But anyways, check it out. Good interview. Lots to talk about, Tim. Big games last night. Lots of playoff implications. Those damn Washington Capitals. Can I just say this? They are a thorn in my side, a team that I just desperately want to lose. And I don't know why. I think it's my pride getting the best of me because I said that thing about Ovechkin, and I've just had this ongoing battle with everybody from Washington. Their beat reporters, the fans, everybody involved with the team. I'm just like, you guys suck. I don't know why. I just don't like this team. Maybe it was because I played them in the playoffs with the Rangers. I use the term playing loosely. I watched the games. But they win again last night. And it wasn't without some controversy. There was a goal that was disallowed. There was an empty net goal that should not have happened if Tortorella was on his game. They played the Philadelphia Flyers. And then lo and behold, they backed their way into the playoffs. I tried to do some digging. I couldn't figure it out. I think they have the worst goal differential in NHL history to make the playoffs. So they are what? 40-31 with 11 overtime losses. They have a goal differential, everybody, of minus 37. Minus 37. The Islanders are minus 18. Every other team that is making the playoffs is at least 20 goals or above the watermark, plus 20. Those two teams, for some reason, somehow, we know how the Islanders did it. They got hot the last couple months of the season. They've been playing really good hockey. Capitals just suck. Like, there's no rhyme or reason for them to make the playoffs. They just, we talk about it ad nauseum. They find a way to win the game. That's all they do. They're not better than the team. They don't outskill them. Their special teams are hot garbage. Charlie Lindgren played really good, and they score opportunistic goals. That's their team in a nutshell. They suck, but they find a way to win. It's amazing. And when they lose, boy, do they lose. Like, they don't lose close games, 3-1, 4-2. they get their doors blown off. That's why the goal differential is so bad. So if they're losing to Tampa Bay, oh, it's going to be 7-1. Like, it's going to be a good one. But when they win, it's a one goal win. So it's frustrating as a fan, as a media pundit, as a former player, when you see the teams that are chasing them. The Red Wings and the Penguins would be so much more enjoyable to be in the playoffs. Penguins +5 goal differential. Red Wings +4. Both these teams are above the, you know, the watermark for the goals. So, and that's not a huge, you know, factor, but it does. The eye test makes sense there. Teams that make the playoffs plus, teams that don't minus. Capitals -37. But let's dig into how they made the playoffs right now, because the stage is set. All the matchups are in on the East Coast. The West, we still got some work to do. Like I said, Dallas and Vancouver going for the first place. You got LA Kings and Vegas Golden Knights for the last wild card spot. There could be some jockeying for positions. The only ones that are set right now, I believe, are Winnipeg and Colorado. Yeah, those are the only ones that are set. Everybody else is still completely up in the air. So we're going to stay in the East, and let's just talk about that game right there. Philadelphia Flyers, Washington Capitals. Did you see the disallowed goal early on in the game? I think it was first period. It was 0-0. The Philadelphia Flyers enter the zone. They throw a puck on Charlie Lindgren. He blockers it. Everybody thinks he caught it. Lindgren thinks he caught the puck. Nobody knows where it is. So he is kind of unsure. He backs up in his crease. The puck is gone. The refs blow the whistle. All of a sudden, the puck comes down from the heavens, bounces into the net off of Joel Farabee. Very, very, very close to when the whistle blows. But it was a split second afterwards. People were upset about this. If you're the referee, you have to be aware of where the puck is. You have to know. And then there's this thing, it's called continuation play. So if you blow the whistle and you're unsure of where the puck is, but the puck goes into the net a split second after the whistle, the continuation of that play, the puck would have gone in anyways, whether the whistle was blown or not. So there's a little bit of a confusion there whether this goal should count. They go to Toronto, everybody's looking. What do we do? What do we do? They call the goal off. Mistake, Tim? What do you think about that?
I didn't know about the continuation play rule, because I knew there's the opposite rule where technically between the time that it takes the ref to see the play and blow the whistle, you can date it back to the time that he saw the play, just because you know it takes like a second or half a second for that time to happen. I didn't know the opposite was true too, where the play could continue after he blew the whistle if it was happening anyway. If that's the case, that obviously is frustrating for Flyers fans, especially knowing how the game resulted. But at the time, the call on the ice, he didn't see it. He calls the play dead. The puck goes in after. To me, I guess that makes sense. And the fact that they brought it all the way to Toronto and they called it a no goal means that they stood by the ruling on the ice, which I think is fair.
Yeah, you'd have to have a lot to overturn it, because the ref on the ice, boom, no goal. But it's kind of like when a guy shoots it and then the net comes off the pegs. But the puck would have gone in if the net goes off the peg. It wasn't off right. The peg. So it's kind of like that, where, okay, that's a goal, but the net's off. So I'm just going to make a judgment here, a judgment call, and say that should have been a goal. I think it should have been a goal. And I'm not saying this because of the Washington Capitals and my hatred towards them. It's just logically looking at the situation, that puck's in the net. It should have been a goal. No one knew where it went. Everybody was confused. The puck's up in the air, bounces in. The whistle blows, what, half a second before? Nobody reacts to the whistle and all of a sudden just stops playing. Everybody had already stopped playing. They were just standing there. And the puck goes in. So tough break for the Philadelphia Flyers. The game is 0-0. Of course, our buddy Alex Ovechkin scores the first goal. Flyers come back and tie it 1-1. This is where things get interesting. The Philadelphia Flyers needed to win this game in regulation. And I'm sure you all know this, so I'm not going to dwell on it too much. They needed to win in regulation in order to have any chance for the playoffs. Capitals needed to lose in regulation. It's 3 minutes left. They're scoreboard watching. At the same time, the Red Wings are playing the Montreal Canadiens. Montreal is up 4-3. So the Flyers are happy. They pull their goalie. They're ready to go. Right before they pull their goalie, right before, the Red Wings tied up with 3 seconds left versus the Montreal Canadiens. On the broadcast that you're watching, the Flyers announcer's like, are you kidding me? They just scored with 3.5 seconds left. How does this happen? They're showing replays. Everybody's upset. 20 seconds later, very short moment of time, the Flyers pull their goalie. Why? Why would they do that? They know what's happening in Detroit. They have video people. They have walkie-talkies that you can talk to the bench. Like, that's... everybody has it. why would they still pull their goalie, Tim? This is the part that makes it frustrating for Pittsburgh Penguins fans, for Detroit Red Wings fans. You're watching this Philly game and you're going, you're giving Washington the win. You are officially eliminated now that Detroit has picked up 1 point. They are 3 points clear of you. You can't make the playoffs. You're done. Now you, because you're not doing your due diligence or you're just plain dumb, are pulling your goalie. You're affecting two other teams and their chances of making the playoffs. So is this Tortorella just being a dummy? Is this the video team in Philadelphia just not figuring it out, not doing basic math? Because you're costing other teams a chance to go to the playoffs. And you're giving Washington the win. Of course they're going to score an empty netter. Of course they are. And they did it right away. They pulled their goalie 10 seconds later, TJ Oshie goes down and scores. 2-1, Washington wins. Did you like this call? Or are you going to give them some slack and maybe they didn't know?
Well, I was trying to give them some slack and thinking, okay, you know, if they knew they were going to be eliminated anyway, maybe you still pull the goalie if you were down a goal. Doesn't matter that it's game 82 and you have no chances of making the playoffs. You still want to win every game in the season with a W. Like, that would have made sense to me. And even if you disrupt the Wings and the Penguins playoff chances, whatever, like, I still want to score that goal to win this game 82, even if it doesn't help us make the playoffs. But the fact that that wasn't the case, they were tied. And I would try to give them some slack for the fact that they pulled the goalie technically, even though it didn't matter because Detroit had already scored. But you had chances. There were face-offs. The play was blown dead. Like, you had chances to catch up. You know, like, 20 seconds is not a lot, but a couple of minutes had gone by playing 6-on-5, and you had a chance to catch up with the news. So I don't know if no one brought it to him or if he ignored it or if he had a rule saying, like, hey, listen, whatever happens in the other game, don't tell me. I'm focused on this one. We know the situation going into the game. That's what I'm going to operate with, and that's the decision that I'm making. Maybe he said that to his team. I don't know.
Yeah.
But it's really strange and disappointing for sure, for especially the Red Wings fans, I think, that had done everything right. Just an incredible game. There's that face-off. You're down with 7.7 seconds left. They win back the draw. You go D to D. Perron just launches a one-timer, and you score with 3.3 seconds left to give yourself a chance to win in overtime and secure a playoff spot. And you do everything right. Just the most incredible, amazing comeback after doing it last night, too, or two nights ago. And then it's ruined by an empty net goal on a 6-on-5 game in a tie-to-tie. You know, it's just like, man, that's really frustrating. It's a tough pill to swallow for those fans.
Yeah, we had to get one of the players on and get them to comment on what they thought about Philadelphia's pulling of the goalie. And then even that game in itself had some controversy because Montreal ices the puck. They shoot the puck down the ice with 7-8 seconds left. It goes for icing, but both of Detroit Red Wings' D-man were right there. They just stopped skating, and the ref's right there, too. It could have easily been waved off, and this would have been null and void. Montreal would have won. Philadelphia would have still pulled their goalie, but just controversy all over the place. Referees interjecting themselves into the game. The Philadelphia no goal, the icing in Montreal. It was wild stuff. But yeah, you got to give props to the Red Wings. Down again early and by multiple goals. Coming back, scoring in the last minute. In the last 10 seconds, Tim, taking it to overtime, getting their points. They took care of their business. But yeah, very exciting stuff. Can you remember a time like this where there was this much action going into the last game and so much unknown? Five teams going for two spots.
No. We certainly had meaningful game 81, 82 before, but it's usually two teams fighting over one spot, whether they're playing each other or fighting or playing different opponents, trying to win those 2 points. That's not that atypical, although it doesn't happen every year. But this type of, like, where there's four or five different scenarios where four different teams could technically make it in is just so much fun. And it makes every second, every play matter. And you're watching, like, if you're Pittsburgh, you didn't play last night. You're watching both of these games and you're hoping for a very specific set of outcomes. And Detroit does it. And then stinking Torts and the Flyers just ruins it for everyone. They let the empty net goal, and Oshie's empty net goal eliminated three different teams just with that goal, which is just... Yeah. It's crazy to think about.
It is what it is. Washington's going to the playoffs now. And they play the New York Rangers. That'll be a fun series to watch. But yeah, like we said, all the series are set. Who are the matchups, Tim, here?
Yeah, so you got the Rangers versus Washington. That's the 1v8. And then you have Boston versus Toronto.
Oh, boy.
Because Florida Panthers won last night to win. So which, hey, my prediction, by the way, was wrong officially about them Bruins winning the Atlantic. Because Florida won it last night. So then Florida gets Tampa, and then Carolina gets the Islanders. John, who do you think is the most exciting matchup and the one that you're going to snooze right through?
Well, I think the most exciting one is Boston-Toronto, right? That's the one that's going to get all the press. They play each other all the time. And then I'm really excited to see Florida-Tampa Bay. Inter-Florida matchup, I think that'll be fun. The one I'm going to snooze through, it's Rangers-Capitals. Right. I think that'll be a 4-game sweep. And then the Hurricanes Islanders will be fun, too. But I think that'll be pretty heavily weighted towards the Hurricanes. But those two matchups, Florida, Tampa Bay, Boston, Toronto, will be very fun to watch. The Atlantic was stacked this year. They had a lot of good teams. And then here's my question. Are you happy the Bruins got bumped down to second to face the Maple Leafs rather than first and take on the Tampa Bay Lightning?
Oh, yeah. I'd much rather play Toronto than Tampa. I think Tampa is just like just a dangerous team. And Vasilevskiy was really, really strong in the second half. And obviously their Kucherov and Point and all those guys, Stamkos went on a heater. Like those guys scare me way more than Matthews and Marner. And not to say they're not talented and it won't be a tough series, but I'd way rather play Toronto.
Interesting. Both good teams. But I guess the Bruins do have the Leafs number. Obviously, Toronto slayed the Dragon, so to speak, a few years back. But this is a... I don't know if this is good for Boston or not. I think they were maybe the underdog in both series. That's crazy to think.
We're going to talk more about it on Monday. We're doing a live show again on Bleacher Report. So check out for some more information on that in our social channels. But I will give a little teaser. I think Boston's going to go right through Toronto. I think it's going to be at the most 5 games. I think they're going to go right through them. Just a gut feeling I have. We'll dig into it more next week. But I just don't. I'm not scared of them. And I think it has nothing to do with I don't have any data sets to prove it. But and this is not a homer pick necessarily, because I would have picked Tampa over Boston. I just am not threatened by Toronto right now.
Is it their defense, their goaltending, their forwards? What is it about them?
It's overall energy and feeling. It's just like the fact that no one's taking Boston too seriously because of who they were last year. And you're not even looking at this team objectively. You're just looking at how much worse and less deep and strong than they were compared to last year. Everyone's doing it. And I think Toronto just is so much. It'd just be so sweet to see them lose in the first round again after thinking you made some progress last year and realizing that's just a blip on the radar. And this is who they are. And again, nothing will probably change, but we'll talk about it more on Monday's show.
Yeah. And then you almost feel bad for the Leafs because they have come into. You know, they're competitive. They're a good team. But they are coming into a situation over the last 7 years where you're just playing juggernauts in your division. The Bruins, the Tampa Bay Lightning, just fantastic. As soon as Tampa Bay starts to falter a little bit, as soon as the Bruins lose their top guys, oh, here comes the Florida Panthers. Like, just another wagon in your division that you have to deal with. So, you kind of feel for them a little. Not a lot, but there is that certain sense of like, man, if they were in another division, if they were in another conference, if they were in another era, they'd be way more successful because they have a very good team, but they just can't seem to get the breaks, can't seem to put it together. But like you said, we'll talk about that on Monday, the live show, the big fantastic Bleacher Report. It's going to be a lot of fun. Check it out. We're going to go through all the matchups and eventually pick our Stanley Cup winner. It's going to be hot and heavy. Very, very, very fun. All right. What are we doing now, Tim? I heard this episode is brought to you by NordVPN.
It sure is. We talked about this last month. By now, I think most of you are familiar with VPNs, but in case you haven't, a VPN means virtual private network. It offers two key benefits, enhanced privacy and security online. But it does a lot more than that, too. It shields your IP address, changes your browsing location, makes online life easier. Why is that important? We talked about this last time. Browsing location. Andrei Vasilevskiy the other night said he's not watching the games because he doesn't have cable and there's regional blackouts in certain games that he wants to watch. If he had a VPN, he could watch those games. And I've done it many times where, like, I want to watch Carolina on a streaming service, but I'm in Charlotte. I don't have cable. It's blocked on the streaming services. With a VPN, I'm able to access. Stuff like that is really important. As we talked about, too, there's always, like, certain shows that are only available in certain networks or discounts or products online and online shopping that are only available in certain areas. So you can change your location. You can go anywhere in the world. I set it up literally less than 2 minutes. Give your information. Away we go. It's very, very easy. It's easy to do. And you can turn it on and off with a click of a button. So it's really, really great. And the good thing is, if you check it out yourself at www.nordvpn.com/DTG for dropping the gloves, You can access 4 bonus months when you sign up for a 2-year plan. Guys, there's no downside to this. Go check that out.
Where did you put your IP location? Was it somewhere fun?
I changed it up. I go to like New York and then London, and I haven't explored the whole world yet, but I want to see like, what does it look like from Beijing or I don't know, South Africa or China or whatever, you know?
So I wouldn't touch China. I would probably leave China alone. I would leave Russia alone, and I would leave North Korea alone. Maybe not go near Iran.
Yeah, you can't go anywhere in the world. There's like 40 or 50 spots you can select. And there's most of them are in the US and Canada too, a whole bunch of them. So
let's just keep it in the Commonwealth. You know what I mean? Just keep it friendly. But anyways, so moving on. What are we going to talk about next here?
Well, I was wondering about this. So right now, the teams in the East are set, and the teams in the West have a good idea of they're playing one of two teams. And you have, it's not like the NFL where you know for like 2 weeks who you're playing and you have a whole week and all this. You have a couple of days, and maybe there's some lead up going on where, you know, like, hey, we're playing either Tampa or Toronto. Let's start game planning either team. But what's happening right now with the coaching staffs, with the players in some cases, 3 days leading up to it and, you know, factoring travel for half the teams. What kind of preparation takes place at this point, and how deep does it go, and how detailed does it go, and who's involved?
I know the teams that are obviously in the playoffs, they know a good idea of who they're going to play in the playoffs about a week and a half ago. So they have, you know, a list of 2 to 3 teams, and they start doing their pre-scouting, and they play these teams throughout the year. Like, look at Boston, Toronto. They play each other how many times? 5, 6 times during the season. So they're familiar with each other, but they do a little in-depth thing where they go into the special teams. Power play, penalty kill tendencies. It's very minimal stuff just because you're so familiar with them, but more so, you just focus on yourself. You try to find matchups. You try to figure out which players play better against other players. And then for the video guys, you dig into the goaltending a lot. You go, okay, where is this goaltender weak? How do we score on him? Where do we have the best chance to shoot on him? You do a lot more work in that regard. But just on a day-to-day basis, you try to keep it the same. The routine is huge, but you do dig in more on the PK/PP, those sorts of things. How do they break out? What are their tendencies in the offensive zone? How do we shut down these guys? Those sorts of things become more common. You maybe take aside your top pairing. Like if you're the Rangers, you take Fox and Lindgren. You go, okay, we're playing this team, the Washington Capitals. This is how Ovi likes to shoot. You guys, we played him a million times, but watch for this tendency. Dylan Strome, when he does this play, when he shoots this way, he has this tell. So you kind of break down different players, high-end players, to try to stop them. But for the most part, especially we talked to Matt Duchene, he's like, we're focused on us. We know there's a group of 3 teams we might play. We're worrying about our end here. We're going to try to, you know, focus on us playing at a high level once we hit the playoffs. But it's all done right now with the coaches. They'll have a package. They'll do a meeting. They'll have lots of video. But right now, it's just like, okay, tunnel vision, what do we have to do to win? So I know it's cliche, but that's how it works. You don't want to overload the players with just a ton of crap, right? They come in and like, you got to learn the PK, the PP. This is how they break out. This is a neutral zone. This is this and this. It's just too much. So you'd rather focus on, okay, this is how we're working our system. Let's get that down and let's just try to go right through them. Like you said, the Bruins and the Leafs.
Yeah, like, does it depend on the team they're playing too? Like, are you prepping that differently for Toronto versus Tampa Bay? Just knowing that, you know, at the end of the day, the preparation's 5% different versus the team like Carolina that has a very, very distinct and specific style and system that maybe takes a little bit of extra work to prepare for.
Yeah, I think you have to cater it to the team. A team like Carolina, you have to play against their system. Yes, they have good players, but they all play the exact same way. So you're like, okay, how do we break out versus this team? Their D-men pinch, their forwards always high. How are we going to catch this team? Maybe we do the high flipper, maybe we reverse, hit the guy high and through the middle. So you have to coach against the system versus a team like Toronto. You coach against the players. So you have to be aware of who you're out against. You're trying to line match. Or on the other side, if you're, you know, the underdog, if I'm the Washington Capitals, or if I'm the Nashville Predators, if I'm a, you know, a wild card team, how am I going to beat this high seed? How am I going to beat the New York Rangers? Well, I know the New York Rangers are pretty one-dimensional. They're a power play heavy team. They're a first-line team. Don't take penalties. Biggest one, discipline. And then we need to shut down that first line. We got to shut down Panarin. We got to shut down Kreider. We got to shut down Zibanejad. If we can do that, we have a chance. So if I'm a, you know, a lower seed team, I'm trying to find ways to poke holes in the higher end seeded teams. Okay, Shesterkin, shoot everything on the blocker. weak on the blocker. Don't go glove. Don't go side to side. He's too fast. Everything on the blocker. Ovechkin, don't let him take, or Ovechkin's a lower C, but you know what I mean? Just poke holes. McDavid, don't let him wind it up. Stay on his hip. Don't let him get the puck where he can get going. So you have to find little areas where you can exploit and get an advantage, because if you don't, you're just going to lose. The team's too good. So yeah, there's different preparation between different teams for sure.
Do you always, like, do they always game plan against the specific players on their opponents, or does it only matter if they have a game breaker type, like a Kucherov, McDavid, McKinnon, whatever? But say Philly had gotten in, they don't have any one guy.
Or even like an Islanders team.
Yeah, would you still pick out like Konechny and Farabee, whoever? Or do you say like, let's, we look at them as a team as a whole?
Yeah, I think you do have to, yeah. You take away their best line. So every team has a first line, and you have to figure out how to thwart that line and take care of business. And like, you know, a team like the Islanders, it's Barzal, it's Horvat. You have to take care of that one line. What do they do good? How can we, you know, eliminate their opportunities? So yes, and you have the best defenseman in the world if you're a top team, like the Rangers or the Dallas Stars. You talk to Heiskanen, you talk to Fox, and you say, okay, we're matching you up against that line. This is what they like to do. This is how you go about your business, and then shut them down. And you talk to the forwards who will be covering those guys too. So yeah, oh, absolutely. And it just prepares you for the second and third round, like getting that mindset. Okay, here's my job. I'm shutting this line down. This is what I'm going to do. And away we go. Carolina Hurricanes, their third line with Jordan Martinook is perfect at this. I play with Jordan Martinook in San Jose, Arizona. Incredible defensive forward. He might even be their fourth line. I think it's Stahl, Martinook, and somebody else. They are very, very good at just shutting a line down and getting a little bit of offense out of it. He prides himself in doing that. It's incredible. His work ethic, his attention to detail. He's so good at just getting in someone's hip, being a pest, and then being effective offensively too. He's not just there to just strictly shut someone down. So yeah, he would be a perfect example of a guy who just say, Brendan Moore is going to go to him. He's going to say, hey, take out that line. That's your job. Whenever they're on the ice, I'm going to tap you. You go and take them out. And he does. And it's he takes pride in it. So it's fun. And hopefully every team has that line. But Carolina, they do a really terrific job at it, Tim.
Do you see guys like changing their roles too? Or like I'll pick on Charlie Coyle saying, hey, you know what? Like in this matchup, we only want you on Matthews. Don't even worry about anything else but just being on Matthews' hip and taking him out of the game. Versus like, because he's been a pretty productive player offensively this year. Do you just let him play his game and know that he already knows what to do?
Yeah, I think you got to read the series. Like right now, I think the Bruins are outmatched offensively versus the Toronto Maple Leafs. So maybe he has to be more focused on the defensive end. Because if you don't, if he's just going to try to score and go, you know, shot for shot with the Leafs second line, you're in trouble. So you have to read the matchup. And if I'm Charlie Coyle and I look across the ice and there's Nylander, Matthew Nyes, John Tavares, maybe Bertuzzi, I can't be too focused on the offensive end. I have to be way more worried about the D zone, because if I'm not, we're going to lose. So yeah, 100%. I think you have to play your matchups and play to your strengths. Bruins going into Toronto, they will be outmatched offensively. So how do you win the game? You slow the game down. You make it hard to go through the zones. You hit and you play solid defensive, and you have to just jump all over their chances that they give you. Their mistakes. And I think the Bruins can do that. Well, you probably think the Bruins are better offensively than Toronto team, don't
no,
you?
No, I know they're not. I know that.
But it's just one of those things where you have to read your matchups. Whereas if they were playing Tampa Bay, maybe I would tell Charlie Coy, you know what? Let's exploit the second line matchup, because their first line's out of this world. But you match up pretty well versus Cirelli and Hagel and Stamkos. They're smaller, more shifty. Use your size. Bully them. Get going. And so you just kind of read the matchup and see where it goes. And if it's not working out, then you adjust.
Last question on this topic.
I feel like I'm getting interviewed, Tim.
Well, I'm very interested in this. I think our listeners probably are too. What about the guys who are like the seventh defenseman or the 13th forward or the black aces? What is this like for them? Because are they told like, hey, you know, someone gets hurt, your first guy in, or, you know, if we can't shut down Matthews, Adam McQuaid, I'm moving you into a top four role because I think you can, you know, play that situation type of thing. Like, do you, where otherwise he might be a scratch. Like, how do those guys prepare?
I think like you usually do. They don't tell you you're going to play if something goes wrong. There's not conversations like that. But you know what's going to happen. Like, I don't know who their seventh D-man is in Boston. But yeah, if something goes wrong, you're going to be in. But you just go about your business and you play. And then after the game, you go out and you know, have a couple drinks and you enjoy yourself. That's what I did when I was with the Rangers. But I knew wholeheartedly I wasn't playing. So, but if you're a guy in the bubble, you stay ready 100%. Because especially goalies now. Look at Swayman. Who's starting, Swayman or Allmark, game one?
That's a good question. I think I'm going Swayman, but it is not clear. It was so clear in the first half. In the second half, Allmark played really well. And in this idea that like Swayman kind of stole the job this year, but it's not quite true. Their stats are very, very close again. And I haven't seen it. Maybe it's just implied that Swayman gets the net, but I don't know. Allmark started last night, so we'll see.
Oh, no kidding. That's very telling. They played what? Swayman's played 43 games. Allmark played 39. Their stats are almost identical. It's remarkable, these goaltenders. It has more to do with the system than the goaltenders, I think, a little bit in Boston. But all right, Tim, let's do some quick hits and get out of here.
Our quick hits, as always, are brought to you by DoorDash. And possibly for the last time, for a limited time, our listeners can get 25% off and zero delivery fees on their first order of $15 or more. Download the DoorDash app, enter promo code NATION25, valid in Canada. There was an announcement last night. Jack Edwards, play-by-play for the Bruins for a better part of two decades, is going to retire officially after the last night's game. So, you know, the announcement came from the Bruins. I'm sure he'll have some press tour or event where he'll speak, and he's already released a statement, but wanted to get your take on that.
You know, for as much as we butted heads, Jack Edwards and I, he was good for the game. Eyes on the game. It was sad to see him just kind of just degrade, almost is the word this year, or just kind of, you know, something was up. There's something wrong with him, and it was sad to watch him kind of fall into that. But yeah, he kept it interesting. Maybe he crossed the line a few times. Maybe he didn't know what he was talking about. He definitely was a Bruins homer, but that's what you expect from him. So it was always fun to listen to him. But yeah, it was tough this year to watch him a little bit.
Yeah, I didn't know he was a homer until really like the last 5 years. As I got older, it started watching other broadcasts and be like, oh, they aren't all like, you just thought it's like he had like main character syndrome for the Bruins, where everything either happened to them or against them. And to some degree, that was a lot of fun to watch. And I'll just say, as a Bruins fan, like, you know, basically as long as I can remember, he was calling games. And all these great moments in the last 20 years with Savard and Char and rebuilding the core and the cup runs and Bergeron and Marchand and all these guys, he was the voice for all of it. So he's really, you know, a huge part of this era of Bruins hockey, and he will be missed. But at the same time, it was time, not only for the fact that he was, you know, something's up with his ability to form words, which I think we can all relate to sometimes, but I think time for change was coming anyway. So I wish him all the best, and hopefully he's healthy.
We should maybe throw our hat in the ring for that job.
Someone texted me that last night. Said, let's get you and John on the Bruins. You and John on the Bruins broadcast.
That'd be fantastic. I was a Bruins fan growing up. They were my team. So I would absolutely love that. Let's make some calls, Tim. I would move to Boston. I really would. My wife wouldn't. My kids wouldn't. But I would. I think it'd be a lot of fun.
We'll get a two-bedroom together, you and I.
Imagine that. Oh, my gosh. That'd be great. North End. Just go. I know Ray Bork. We can go to his Italian restaurant every night. Fun. All right. What else, Tim?
Connor McDavid broke yet another record with his 100th assist the other night, joining only three other players to ever do it: Wayne Gretzky, Mario Lemieux, and Bobby Orr. Just an incredible feat and another, you know, feather in his cap.
How good was Bobby Orr? Like, let's just put this into perspective, because Lemieux, Gretzky, offensive juggernauts, McDavid, obviously we know what he does. Bobby Orr, Tim, at a time when D-Man didn't even cross the blue line, 100 assists. It's incredible. Oh, go ahead.
No, go ahead. You got it.
I think he gets undervalued of how good he was just because his career was cut short. What did he play, 7 or 8 years? He didn't play very long. He just dominated when he was in the NHL. He was so incredibly good. If he plays a whole career's worth of hockey, hands down the best player ever. Not even close. That's how good he was. He was so, so different from anything we had ever seen before in the NHL. Created a brand new position.
I've always thought of it likened to the Beatles, just a huge, massive impact for such a short time and a similar era, too, where we're still talking about them years later. It's just the impact that they had on their spheres. I was going to say, there's this tweet that was going around like a year or two ago of someone saying her boyfriend's dad was in a Bruins Facebook group, a Bobby Orr fan page, where all they did, like a couple times a day, one of the dads would just, or old time Boston guys would just post a clip and talk about how good Bobby Orr was, and then everyone would agree. And they would just do that. And then they would just do that every day. Cause that's, these are the guys that grew up watching him, you know.
It's
just
funny.
The impact that he had, it's, you know, it's Larry Bird, it's Bobby Orr, and now probably Ortiz and Brady, just the
stop. Not even close.
Icons in Boston. Moving on. Another record was set this week. Jeremy Lauzon had 9 hits the other night to set an NHL record of 383. He broke a record that was previously held by Matt Martin, which I think is interesting because it's a forward and a defenseman playing different positions, different styles of games, but pretty impressive.
It's a stupid record. Hits are one of the biggest joke out there. You go to a different arena, the stats guy will mark hits completely different from another arena across the country. It's just bizarre. I remember playing in the old Coliseum, the New York Islanders. You would go in there, Cal Clutterbuck and Matt Martin, they would say at the end of the game, had like 15 hits. Saying, what game are you watching? It's just amazing. They go and like blow on somebody. They give them a hit. So it's all a sham. The stats guy knew how many hits Jeremy Lauzon needed, and miraculously he gets it, you know, in the last game of the season. Isn't that great? So it's just all a joke. The hits tallying, one of, if not the biggest shams in the NHL. It should be, I don't know how to quantify it. Because you have eyes and I have eyes. A hit for me is not a hit for you.
There was one time, I don't know, I was a freshman or sophomore and in high school, we were watching the varsity game, and one of the assistant coaches came to us before the game because all the JV players had watched the game together. And he said, hey, can you guys each take a piece of paper and write down every time you think a hit should have happened but didn't? Because I want to call out our team for not being physical enough, and just write like the number of the player and just check each time they didn't follow through on a hit. And I was doing it like every opportunity possible. And I realized each of them had like 20 for the first period. And the coach looked at it. He's just like, yeah, no, this isn't helpful to me. And it's just my point is that it is super subjective. And it is, that said, I feel like I've poked a little bit of a tender spot. You have some strong feelings about this.
Well, no, because we actually, when I was with Houston, we had Kevin Constantine, very statistical guy. He kept track of everything. Before the season, we took a test on our systems. And you had to pass this test in order to play. And I studied my tail off, and I actually got the highest grade on the test, and I got some kind of prize. But all that aside, he would mark after every game. You would have impact hits, and you would just have regular hits. And so after the game, the next day, he would show up at the rink, and there would be a chart. It would say missed hits, total hits, and impact hits. And the impact hits were the big hits that made a difference. And you could chart, and it was all right there. And nobody ever had more than like 10 hits. You know what I mean? Like, and he was very detailed, and he watched the whole game. The guy was just a Nazi about this stuff. And to see like guys getting 10, 15, 20 hits in a game, it just drives me bonkers. So yeah, it's not true. It's all smoke and mirrors at this point. 382 hits. That's incredible. That's what? 8, 16, 24, 32. That's 5 hits a game. It doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. But good for Jeremy Lauzon. You can tell his kids, I got a fake award in 2024.
Yeah. Okay. One more here. Kent Hughes announced the Canadians have exercised a 2-year option on Marty St. Louis as the head coach. He's got one more year on his existing contract, and he'll do 2 more after that, which is, I think, it's well-deserved, well-earned. And, you know, you can see finally there is something to these young players. Slavkovsky's starting to break out. They added Lane Hutson, who's just in his 2 games, like skating like you wouldn't believe. You see him working the blue line? He's very like prime Klingberg, like the way that he was just known for working the blue line really well and playing with confidence already. So good for Marty St. Louis.
What do you think he makes? Top of your head.
Oh, geez. I don't know. $3 million. I don't know what coaches
make. You nailed it right on. $3 million.
Nice.
Yeah.
See, big brain. I am smart.
You are smart. And then back to the Hutson. It's incredible the kids coming out of college. Like just the poise, it's crazy. It shouldn't happen. There needs to be a rule. Was it here that I talked about how they have to have some kind of gauge about these kids coming in? Because it shouldn't be allowed. Like just say Montreal was a contending team. You're getting a very solid NHL player.
Well, think about like, if he was the Bruins player, right? He fits in exact need they have because McAvoy doesn't skate like that. And that's, he's very good. He doesn't move like that. And Hampus Lindholm could and should, but he hasn't been. And so if they'd added Lane Hutson, which is a huge gap on their power play, their blue line, that just would have made a huge difference on their team that I could see other fans being not happy with. So I get that.
Something needs to change them. Vegas Golden Knights cheating. There's a lot happening. It's a lot. Duchene was so funny, that interview. You can tell he wanted to let loose, but he could. All right, I think that's it, Tim. Anything else?
No, listen to the Duchene interview, buy a t-shirt, have a great weekend.
Where do they buy our t-shirts?
Our links, our social links have all the stuff there. So you can go check that out, or Everything Hockey's website, droppingthegloves.com has links. They're everywhere.
How's that going, by the way? We selling a bunch?
Yeah, we are. We got to sell more.
People are buying. I haven't gotten any money for it.
That's because you will. We have a partnership.
I haven't seen a dime. That's how it always goes with Tim. He's got these grand ideas. Nothing comes from it. This is the one, though.
Go buy a shirt. This is different.
Go buy a sweatshirt. It's going to be great. All right, everybody. Enjoy this episode. Enjoy the Matt Duchene interview on Thursday, and we'll talk to you guys next week for the start of the playoffs. My goodness. Have a good weekend. Cheers.
Thanks for listening to Dropping the Gloves with John Scott, a member of the Nation Network of Podcasts. Subscribe wherever you get your podcasts from to never miss an episode.